Hello everyone. Today I would like to share a team story with you. I do work with two teams at Zalando, and those two teams are part of a bigger group of people, and our purpose is developer productivity. So we want to make sure that developers at Zalando are as productive as possible. And part of those developer productivity group is CI/CD infrastructure, cloud infrastructure, testing infrastructure, and other things. And the way we try to make our developers at Zalando happy is that we'll automate as much as we can. So we are also developers, and we do actually dog food most of the stuff we develop ourselves. And this is a story where we did not actually develop something, but we found out something, we shared it in the community at Zalando, in the developer community. And for some of them, it was maybe useful, and maybe it's useful for you as well. Now, if you have any questions, feel free to ask questions at any time. The slides are shared anyway later. You can watch the slides later. Even if I run out of time, I can stop sharing the slides. I want your questions to be answered. This bigger group of developer productivity is part of Zalando Tech. This is around 2,000 developers, and we have headquarters and all those nice pictures. What I personally found most interesting about that is there are colleagues from so many nations all over the world. It's such a multicultural environment that it's really interesting to hear those stories, not only on a professional context, but also on a broader context, like where people are coming from, what food they like, and so on and so forth. The way we as developer productivity like to serve our customers, the developers best, is also the way the company tries to serve their customers. For all of you, by the way, who shopped with Zalando already? Thank you. So for all the customers within Europe, the company tries to have locations all over the place to serve those packages best in case you want to shop with Zalando fashion. Now, I mentioned already, I do work with two teams. From time to time, I try to code a bit, and I also sometimes write something on my blog. This is a turtle. And this turtle is how I felt the Docker image of one of the teams I worked with initially when they started to do this project. And I thought, well, you know, a turtle looks like this if it's an adult turtle, but it looks actually like this if it's just hatching. So this turtle just hatched 20 seconds ago before I took this picture, and it's as big like this. Whereas this guy, I didn't take this picture, but this guy is roughly like this, right? And what I had in mind when I saw this big Docker image was like, there must be a way to make it a little bit smaller, maybe not as small as this guy, but there must be a way. And so we started that whole process to trying to find out how can you reduce the Docker image size. And why do we do that? Or why do we believe this makes sense? So pulling and pushing Docker images might be quicker if it's smaller, right? It's a natural thing. And we also thought, like, you know, if it's smaller, there is less stuff in there. Maybe the security, the attack security attack surface is also smaller. And in this talk, I try to tell you what we made with that. And I thought, like, can I really prove that? Can I show you facts that prove that? And the answer is no. I can't show you hard facts. Throughout this whole talk, I show you only indicators. And even if you see numbers, those are only indicators, right? You can quote me, you can take pictures, but these are one-time indicators. It's not an on average or an industry standard or something like this. This is our experience. Okay, enough of introduction. This is where we started. By the way, this is a Docker file. Who is not familiar with Docker files? Docker. Professionals here. Oh, but still, I want to make sure there was one hint. I want to make sure in general you understand the concept. It's a declarative form of describing a Docker image, right? And it gets interpreted, and then it gets an image kind of thing, and you store it somewhere, right? And as Zalando, the Docker is the main deployment format. We run most of our services in Kubernetes, some of them in AWS, but regardless of AWS or Kubernetes, definition is in Docker files, and that's why I use it here. Okay, this specific Docker file is open source on GitHub available, and I did do this because in case you want to follow up later, you can check out the code. The actual Docker file is a closed project within Zalando premises, and I can't share that with you, but all the general concepts are reflected in those Docker, in this Docker file and in the following Docker file. And basically what it does, it uses some Golang code, and then it runs this code, right? This is basically what it does. And what's the outcome? We have an image which is compressed on Docker Hub, 300 megabytes big. And in this case, I did build it with CircuitCI. You can build it with any CIs. Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
What's the underlying distro under the Golang 1.11?
Very good question. I don't know. I assume it's Ubuntu. I don't know.
That's the mistake.
there are many mistakes you will find out throughout my talk. The build and push time and pull time is what I recorded here. And this is the big turtle that I have in mind. And what you can do is what you just said, you can change the base image. As you can see here, we still go with the Golang. But the first thing we tried to cache this. And here, with Docker build using a cache, we reduced one thing out of those parameters. Again, you can come up with more parameters. This is just what we found useful. And for CircuitCI, it went down from 3 seconds build time to less than 1 second build time. Now, if you want to build Docker images, you can use a so-called builder pattern. And translated into Docker files, this builder pattern basically means there are two parts. You'll just use a base image, which has all the binaries in order to compile your stuff and create your binary. And then you have a very thin base image, and I assume this was also the idea of what you just mentioned, that you put this binary onto, and then you just use that very thin base image for your final Docker image. And this is implemented here. So you see up here, part one, again, we're gonna use the Golang base image for building this stuff. And port two is Alpine. Maybe this is more what you like. It's definitely smaller than the Golang base image. You give it a label because you need to refer to that somehow. And later here in the copy, you say like from this stage, copy from, and take it, and then you just run. One more thing, as the team, oh, I forgot to say, most of the teams can choose the programming language at Zalando Tech. So when this project was started, it is a wrapper around the GitHub Enterprise API, the team was able to choose amongst a certain set of languages. The set of languages is basically the Zalando Tech Radar. You find it online and open source. And from those technologies, teams are more or less free to choose. In this case, the team chose Go. They actually did a surprise to me. So I thought they go for Python because they did a lot of Python scripts before, but they choose Go. And with Go, the one nice thing is that you can make static linked binaries. So those binaries, the advantage of those binaries is you'll have them and you'll just run them. You don't need any other environment, just the binary is enough to run them. You need to make sure that you compile it, the binary for the operating system that you want to run it on, but apart from that, you are ready to go. So we went with that approach, and some numbers changed. The biggest change that we experienced was from 300 megabytes compressed on Docker Hub to around 5 megabytes compressed. And also the pull time, when you do want to pull from Docker Hub to a node where no layer is cached, it goes down to 1 second, from 21 seconds to 1 second.
Quick question.
Yeah.
The build time should be increased because there now is another distro which is pulled. So there's the Golang distro pulled being pulled and then the Alpine.
Obviously it didn't. I didn't investigate into that. So I see two options why that wasn't the case. First of all, I do not know the CircleCI workers in detail. So maybe they have some layers cached already. The second thing might be wherever CircleCI workers pull it from might be so close to the actual workers that you don't see that in the numbers. But in the end, I can't say in detail why this is not reflected in the numbers. Yeah.
Oh, I think it even is. It's 0.6 seconds, right?
Yeah, but I mean, 1/10 of a second. is that the time you need to download Alpine? At least if I do that on my local machine, it takes a little bit more, maybe less than a second. You know, again, those numbers are one-time numbers, right? It don't be too picky on tens of seconds here. Those should give you just indications. There are more numbers I can't explain. I'm going to tell you later about that, because I don't think that's the actual point. I think the point is to see a trend, not so much if it's 0.5 or 0.6 seconds. But we can discuss, of course. With that builder pattern approach, we were actually quite happy. Basically because, you know, when you do pull those Docker images and this takes 5 seconds instead of 20 seconds and you do scale up a cluster or you do even scale up an AWS autoscaling group, it really makes a difference if the nodes pull for 5 seconds or for 21 seconds. Still, we thought like maybe there is something else to improve, and we found Docker build options, squash and compress. What they do in general is they try to reduce, again, the Docker image size. Docker squash is an experimental feature. You need to enable that in your Docker config in case you want to use that, and basically makes sure there is only one layer in your Docker image. Docker compress does gzip your image and may reduce it, right? So let's see how that looked like in numbers for our example. There is basically no difference, right? So those numbers aren't really the same. They go up and down, but there is no real difference. So basically, this was a nice try, but nothing really happened, right? That we could use from that. The next step we tried out was like, you know, why should we build in a Docker image? And we couldn't answer this question other than there is no need. So we did build the actual binary in our worker nodes. And for this presentation, I did build it in CI worker nodes, in CircleCI worker nodes. And I then just used the binary that I produced, I added it to the Docker image, and then I just run it. And I did that also with squash and compress, but again, those numbers didn't really differ so much. And this was the result. Again, the numbers do not change really. Also, the numbers for the build time are a little bit slower, but not really. Now you could argue, you know, there is not this layer of Golang and building it in the Golang layer and then remove this layer and just have this Alpine. Again, this isn't reflected in the numbers. Still, from a maintainability point of view, you could argue, okay, such a Docker file is easier to maintain because it's small. You can see from scratch what is actually, or you can see like really quick what is actually meant, whereas this is a little bit longer of a Docker file, so maybe it's harder to spot bugs in case there are any bugs. Anyway, we thought Alpine might not be the end of the story, and this was the end of our story, and I'm happy to hear your story in case your story continues at that. We did use from scratch, which is basically no Docker image, no base image at all. And this was again rather easy for us because it's statically linked binary, as in the step before with the add command. I copied it to the, or we copied it to the Docker image, and then with the CMD we just run it. I compiled numbers for squash and compress again, but this didn't change so much. And we did see some difference in the numbers. So the image size went again down from 5 megabytes compressed to 2 megabytes compressed. And the build time did went up dramatically, right? From let's say 1 second to 16 seconds. At Zalando, we do use a different CI system. I presented that in the very first session of this meetup. That's why we didn't care so much about CircuitCI, because we don't use CircuitCI in production. But it was really obvious that something was different. Maybe it's an outlier because this is a one-time snapshot, but we didn't investigate more into that. And that's the other important number maybe not so important, but that's a number I also can't explain. We just went with that. And yeah. That's basically about from scratch. And so far the team was rather happy with that and continued the development with from scratch. And from time to time, we needed to check something on the, one more question.
What do you need the certificates for?
This is a web service. And if you do use from scratch, there are zero certificates and you can't access anything. And we're just, I think we just used it from Ubuntu. I can't tell you exactly. We just copied it into our main repository and then we just copied it.
Okay.
Yeah. So for everyone who ever did exec into a container, you may have fun like this, because there is some software that you expect to be there, but actually it is not there, right? And in this case, what I wanted to do here is I wanted to start a shell. And because it's from scratch, there is nothing there but my binary image, and my binary image does not contain a shell, and I get this, right? So sometimes ops is more important than DevOps, and this is one of the things, but in general, we like DevOps. Now, the team decided, like, what should we do? What is the best approach that works for us? And the team decided for the Alpine. So it's a little bit bigger, like in terms of image size, but in terms of development speed and how to be able to debug things in case something happens on the container, the Alpine image was the best option for the team. to wrap this number thing up, this is where we started, and those are the like, let's say, a little bit awful numbers, right? So 300 megabytes and 20 seconds pull time for a node without any cached layers pulling from Docker Hub was reduced to 2 megabytes compressed image size and 1 second for Docker Hub pulls for the from scratch image that we do not use, right? But you know, in case you need to present some numbers to your management, to architects, whatever, those would have been the numbers I would present in case they need to be convinced.
You should write the inverse, it's more than the
title. Yes, of course, let's change the numbers. Yeah.
How often do you need log into production images?
We are not allowed to do that. We do follow a hands-off approach with our Kubernetes clusters. Nevertheless, there are of course those cases. We call them emergency or incident access. We do have to file tickets for this. And how often? In general, for the teams I work with, 3 times a week, sometimes 5 times a week.
Okay.
Yeah. So what we'll try to foster and what we'll what the way we try to work is, we'll try to run our CI/CD pipeline as often as we can. And every single change that we apply to whatever stage, production or you name it, that should go via a pipeline. And this is fully automated, so you basically do click it, and we try to avoid those manual steps. No. Still, this manual step I showed you to exec into the container happened more often in the development phase, right, than in the actual production phase. And in the actual production environment, we are not really allowed to do that.
Okay.
Yeah, for Kubernetes. I'm sorry. In Kubernetes, we are not allowed to access the Kubernetes clusters. We are allowed to access the container. We basically do not have write permissions. Right? So we are able to access the container. We can change the we can see the logs, for example, but we are not able to change something. Yeah, this wasn't really clear in my answer before.
Sure.
Okay. The other topic. Oh.
I just wondered, are there any other files in your build directory while building the images?
Mm-hmm. There is one file, one single file, which is our deployment descriptor. We have a deployment.
How much are them? So I'm asking because mm-hmm. If you do a Docker build, you usually if you type it is something like Docker build whatever dot, which means this is the build context, and
mm-hmm.
everything in dot and below gets transferred, to the build engine.
Mm-hmm.
And if there are large files that don't get used, that increases dramatically the build time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I was.
Yeah. So. In general, those Docker files that we use, that the teams use I work with is between 20 and 100 lines maybe. Usual file might be 40 lines. The deployment descriptor might be between 30, 40 lines to 100, 200. So it's, in terms of big file size, is nothing. It's kilobytes, right?
Documentation or libraries that don't get used or something like that in subdirectories or something on.
Yeah.
We often see that.
I can't share that experience. So, to me, it feels like straight to the point. So it's just the code. All the documentation is on a documentation server, but. The way we implement it for other Zalando developers is it's their choice how they design their own projects, right? So if they put whatever 50 megabyte files into their repositories, they are allowed to do so. So we'll try to tell them there is Git LFS and not Git for 50 megabyte files. And in general, 50 megabyte files maybe, but we do not tell them you are not allowed to do so. Yeah.
Okay.
This topic was the first topic I mentioned initially for the purpose was like how much can we reduce it, how do we improve numbers in terms of time and size, and the other topic was the attack surface. And although I did run out of time already, I would shortly talk about this. So if you do have Docker images, there are several open source and closed source projects that allows you to scan your images and to determine like how many CVEs, vulnerabilities are in there. And one of the popular projects that does so is CLAIRE by CoreOS. And if you go to Qui.io, which is also by CoreOS, of course, this is included, and other Docker registries also include similar products. And you can use CLAIRE, which is your which is something that runs on your local machine, to mimic such a scan that happens normally on Docker registries, and this is what I did. And in this example, I did use one of the earlier images with a Golang base image, but here with some cache in the build, and I found 131 vulnerabilities, right? And then there are in different levels and so on and so forth, and in the end, it doesn't matter so much like what number this is, but you see there is more than one or two, right? So there are some vulnerabilities. And now if you want to go into detail, you need to find out what those vulnerabilities are. You get nice reports, including links to the CVEs, and then you can check if fixes are available or not. But in the end, who wants to do that, right? For more than 10 of those vulnerabilities, regardless if it's 1,000 or 100. So there is some stuff to do. And if you do use that image from Scratch, which basically only has the binary, the Golang binary, you have zero vulnerabilities. Again, it's not a surprise because there is nothing in, so there can't be a vulnerability, right? But in general, the approach here, I believe that makes sense to a certain degree, is that the smaller the stuff in your image is, the less likely. I'm not saying there are less vulnerabilities, but the less likely it is that you find vulnerabilities. Those vulnerabilities are only for the Docker images, right? So whatever Golang libraries we may use in our code, of course, can contain CVEs, right? And how important or less important they are compared to those vulnerabilities you find here. This is, again, yet another talk. But the smaller it is in general, the less likely it is that you have those vulnerabilities. So to wrap that up, for us, the potentially reduced developer cycle time was a big topic. And this downloading those images from, in this example, Docker Hub to a clean node, in our example at Zalando, from the Docker registry to Kubernetes pods, did increase quite significantly. The container startup time also did decrease quite significantly, because when a container was started, in our case, it means it needs to be pulled first. And this attack surface is potentially reduced, right? So basically, we didn't do more than that. We just checked the number of vulnerabilities, and we did smoke test some of those vulnerabilities, but we didn't check all of them in detail. What does those vulnerability one by one actually mean? You need a lot of time to do so. And you may come up with more questions than you have before. And if there is time for questions, then let's go with more questions. Yeah.
When these figures are measured?
I'm sorry?
When these figures are measured?
I did measure them with Circuit CI. So you find the link in the slides. The code that I showed is
on. I mean, like, when did you measure them, these figures?
Oh, it was somewhat in October. So that's why I left also the link in the presentation, because if you want to find out, you can check the actual timestamp. So later, if the slides are shared, you can click on this link. And then you find the timestamp. I think it was somewhere in October.
No, I mean today I read the article that this Docker new engine release was published 2 weeks ago. This article said that it can dramatically improve the build time of Docker. I was just wanted to know when this
which Docker version it was?
It was 18.09. So it was just 2 weeks ago it was released. So I just wanted to know. I haven't tried that myself. So
to be honest, let's give it a try.
He's talking about BuildKit.
Yeah, BuildKit.
But BuildKit is still experimental, no?
It's experimental. So unless you explicitly label that, it wouldn't happen.
Yeah. So this is like here on my local machine. Oh, this was, of course, wrong. So here I have 18.06.
So
this is, of course, Docker CE, right? So whenever this little tiny thing on top, where is it, tells me over there, the third one from the left tells me to update, then I update, right? So yeah, maybe I'm not on bleeding edge. And I didn't check what a Docker version on CircuitCI was, but yeah, you can do Docker version and then you have it in your output to find it out. There was, is there a question answered?
Yeah.
There was one, yeah.
I'm a security engineer. I'm more interested in container security.
Mm-hmm.
But there's like some guides or something to follow for this thing.
I'm not a security engineer. That's why I don't know. What I found interesting is when we went through that journey, I found an article from some Google guys about Kubernetes best practices. And this approach of reducing the Docker image size was one of their, was part of that. And in general, I had the feeling that Google shares a lot of security related posts, and that would be the first thing I would search for. Any other question? Yeah.
The single binary approach seems something really Go specific.
It is. Yes.
Did you manage to do the same thing for any other language you used?
No.
So use the reduced image for Python or something
No.
like that?
No, not for this talk, and also not specifically. In general, those teams that I know that use Java go for Uber JARs. You know, you'll try to. This is something I didn't came across, but sounds interesting.
Direct code generation out of Java files.
Okay. Yeah.
Still
sounds interesting.
Experimental, but the FN project guys.
Okay.
Do this a lot.
Okay. Maybe that's a talk for yet another session in the future. I don't know. I just read that there are other languages that also allow those statically linked binaries. I never tried them out. I do not know them from the top of my head.
Okay.
Yeah. The general message here is, if your language supports that, or if you have approaches like this or Uber JARs in JVM-based languages, then you might be able to use reduced base images in your Docker files, maybe. Right.
I mean, in Java, you would probably use JLink to reduce the JVM footprint.
Java 9 or 10.
Sure.
So it seems there are no. Oh, yeah.
You know.
Go ahead. Yeah.
Because we in our case, we are using kind of exactly opposite approach. We try to collect all the Docker image used by the teams, try to find the sharing stuff, and then merely build a single Docker image with a lot of layers.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And then we convert merely in a huge Docker file,
mm-hmm.
and then make a step. In this way, we can mark, and then this preload in all our machine the most common. Usually the operating system plus something, the tools. In this way, we download only the layer.
Yeah.
And then the layer is, in our case, unfortunately, always 200 or 300 megabytes.
Yeah.
But no, you download only the layer that you need. And then this is a big effort, because when you change one upper layer, then you have to rebuild all the images, then all the layers. But that's dramatically improved the startup of the service and so on.
Yeah. That is very reasonable, and we do use a similar approach in Kubernetes as well. But this is also, I think, really company specific, right? So as a company, you may say you basically describe a caching approach, right?
Yeah.
You do cache whatever, right? But if you do cache something, you also decide to cache not something else, because you can't cache the whole world, right? And this is depending on your use case, and that totally makes sense.
That is the main forcing the caching for something that is not designed. No, because we try to find and make the logic of the layer that can be stacked in a certain way and to be simplified and to reduce the download and to have the footprint already preloaded.
Yeah. We do use at Zalando a similar approach, which is base layer. We'll try to follow the base layer approach, and we'll allow teams to define their own base layers. Basically, what we do is inner source, so we do use open source principles within Zalando. But that would be yet another talk, So I decided not to use it here, but yes, from an optimization point of view, this is absolutely something you should look into. Yes, correct.
Fine. Yes.
Looks like there are not more questions. Thank you very much.